Konkan Maratha Entrepreneurs presents Champions of Innovation Series.
Namaskar to all my Konkan Maratha Samaj. Before moving to our topic of interest and guest of recently introduction, many of our community people wanted to know why this platform like Konkan Maratha Entrepreneur existed and what it intends to do in the future. Conceptualized around the objective of nurturing the entrepreneurial talent in Konkan Maratha community, this forum marks a milestone as it completes 4 webinars and received good quality feedback from all around the world. Over the last couple of months, KME platform not just been a platform for new ideas, but has helped nurture our young minds. We have never chased ideas or entrepreneur or enterprises based on the valuation. We have only chased the value, and that was what makes the KME successful. It is the undying spirit of perseverance of Konkan Maratha youth that has kept us going, and we wish to continue and make it much bigger success story in the future. So moving further, the guest of introduction, the today's 5th edition webinar, Champions of Innovation Series, witnessing one of our most established and highly qualified successful entrepreneur and extremely well-known, simple and full of compassion-oriented personality in our community, Dr. Vinayak Naik. And I'm sure you'll be enjoying the scientific and technology-oriented discussion with him. And we famously call him here in the Bard Karwar, Dr. Vinayak Bahu, and he needs no introduction. But it's my pleasure to give some of the introductory glimpses of his successful personal and entrepreneurial journey, known and unknown facts present in front of you. Dr. Vinayak Bahu is an Indian diagnostic pharma industry veteran with close to 5 decades of experience, who have created the valuable Tulip Diagnostic Group of companies that have contributed to India's growth story with the help of 2 friends. Started with the Tulip Diagnostic Company in 1988 with the 8 number of employees. To my surprise and everyone's surprise, this Tulip Diagnostic, over the years, company has grown into 8 group companies with the present employee strength of around 1,200 and with exporting more than 50 countries worldwide. So Dr. Naik's family consists of wife Rekha, and 2 sons, Prashant and Ajay. And Rekha's wife is a postgraduate in commerce and taking care of home. Prashant is a pharmacy graduate and he involved in his own business. Ajay is an electronics engineer and holds an MBA degree also. He is working in HP, California. Just to inform you, all viewers in today's this special edition webinar, attending some of our most inspired legend of our community, Shri Kamlaksh Naik, Dr. Anil Gaonkar, Shri Prakash Rane, and Shri Santosh Rane, and host of all other big delegates also, and few of them watching on the live session with you. On behalf of everyone, a warm welcome to you all. It's one in lifetime opportunity to interact and learn from a legend of our community, Dr. VK Naik. So moving further, I'm going to introduce you on all the webinar topic of interest, the adapting the pace of technological change and how it is going to enrich the knowledge of those who wish to enter or already entered in the field of setting the entrepreneurial business. Just wanted to give some defining link about this mega trend topic. At a glance, with our primary research and secondary research from the global sources, 2 major challenges coming out from this adapting the pace of technological change. The first challenge is that the rapid pace of technological change is dizzying, distracting the entrepreneur or executives from the other challenges. Entrepreneurs see the technology as the number 1 challenge, while the market data ranks as a futuristic mega trend. The second challenge is that entrepreneurs may overstate the challenge posed by keeping up with the competitors on the technology front, feeling pressurized into new investments and worried about the most important thing, and everyone knows this cost part, which was the most selected barrier to adopt the technology. And we all know all Konkan Maratha Samaj business enterprises known for its job works. Some are supplier to the OEM, some are with the proper brand products business, want to use technology, but it often fails too hard or not now kind of a box with many not knowing where to start, how to choose the right solution, or what solutions are available in the market. So some of our Konkan Maratha Samaj business enterprises having a technology adaptation lifecycle maturity with following kind of a maturity cycles. First, some are using the technology, some are not using but considering in the future. Some are like not using and not considering in the future also. So this is the kind of a life cycles in the Konkan Maratha kind of business enterprises. And we, as we all know, the entrepreneurs and executives in today's competitive world confront an expanding array of advanced technologies coming up, like artificial intelligence, big data, blockchain, machine learning, IoT, to create new revenue streams, right from the retailing to pharma manufacturing. So technology encroaches from all angles, driving change the way the business organizes internally, what products go to market, or how the firms engage with their customers. Under these circumstances, it is any wonder, or it's imperative to executive consider keeping pace with the technological change as their greatest barrier. And that's the megatrend story we are going to discuss today with the legend. So Dr. Vinayak Bhav, it's my pleasure to welcome you. Let's begin with the interesting life journey questions, and let me brief the questions to everyone interest. Dr. Vinayak Bhav, everyone here knows that you have been a part of the Indian diagnostic pharma industry serving more than 5 decades. Our community wants to hear how you spent those days in 2 parts of the question. First part, we wanted to hear as a well-qualified student from Bard area to working as a young professional in Johnson & Johnson days. And second part of the questions, your successful Tulip diagnostic entrepreneurial journey, and your community wants to hear from you, what made you to think to start or enter into an entrepreneurial business? How did you start? What are the initial difficulties you faced? Over to you, Dr. Vinayak.
Thank you very much, and welcome to all the listeners and the viewers. As Subhash has asked me to elaborate right from my early days, let me start with my Mumbai journey. That is the first hurdle I have to take care of. I did my post-graduation in physical chemistry, and as the need was there for a suitable job, I tried locally to get either a lecturer job or a demonstrator job in the nearby colleges, but could not succeed. So I was left with no choice, either go to the big cities like Mumbai or Bangalore. And since I had nobody at that time in Bangalore, I decided to go to Mumbai. And fortunately, my maternal uncle was there. I could get sort of assurance from him that I can be staying with them. And when I went there, I was looking for a job desperately. But because of my physical chemistry background, it was very, very tough to get an entry either in any pharma or in a chemical industry. So I was very desperate. 3-4 months I was wandering from pillar to post to find a job which helped me to sustain myself. But that was not the fact. I could not get. And I approached one of my relatives, Mr. Gaukar, Anandu Gaukar from Chende. They helped me in getting a temporary job in Hindustan Lever in the marketing division as a tabulator. At that time, they were doing the market survey of Lux Soap. So I went there, and the job was just merely a clerical tabulating kind of job, not the job I was interested in, but circumstances led me to accept it and pull on. Since then, I was looking very desperately what to do, and getting a job in a pharma or a chemical industry was not a success. I said only alternative is to change my line of, you know, knowledge or something. So I was looking for whether I will get anywhere for a fellowship. And fortunately for me, one of my friend, Dr. Mohan Gaonkar, he introduced me to one of his friends in an institute called Institute for Research in Reproduction. They were looking for students for a PhD course, and that was in biochemistry. I was not sure, because going from physical chemistry to biochemistry, it was not that easy. So I said, let me try and not give it up. So I met the person in IRR, one Dr. Naik. He told me that I'll see that you will be called for interview, but I don't guarantee that you will get the fellowship. I said, okay, at least let me give it a try. Before accepting the defeat, I would take a chance. And just tell you the very interesting incidents happened there. So I was called for interview. But when I went there, about 8 candidates were there for that fellowship interview. I was very shy or reluctant. And as expected by me, that I was the last person to be interviewed. I thought it gave me a sort of indication that, boss, you are not wanted, or you will not get it. Because from physical chemistry to biochemistry. So my turn came for the interview. For the interview panel, there were 3 panelists. One of the director of the institute. Second, the panelist was the dean of JJ Medical College. And third was the director of Hopkins Institute. I greeted them. The first and foremost question was asked by the director. She asked me, see the lady, Rao, my name. He said, are you eligible for this fellowship? So I had no answer. I know in mind that my subject is not. So I kept for some time without answering. And he said, hello, please answer. You have some answer. Then I said, anyway, I'm not going to get it. Let me, you know. I said, ma'am, since you have called me for interview, I feel that I am eligible. All the 3 of them started laughing. I said, I just keep it quiet, knowing that I'm not going to get the fellowship. Then the dean of the second panelist, JJ Medical, told me, post is or this fellowship for working in a biochemical or a medical field where it related to human reproduction and all that, is going to be tough. Then what is your answer? I said, sir, I will learn. That's only that was my answer before me. Sir, I will learn. He said, everybody says that initially they learn, and then slowly they decide. But I said, sir, if I've given an opportunity, I will not run away. And he said, I mean, still you feel that you're hopeful that you will get or you can make it through? I said, definitely, yes. He said, what is the confidence that you have? I said, sir, I have the basic knowledge about chemistry, need to biochemistry and all that. Then the third person, who the director of Hopkins, who said, you have basic knowledge, sort of, in a different tone. I said, sir, yes. He said, I will ask you 3 basic questions. Will you reply? I said, I will try. He said, I'm not going to ask you for big questions and all the 3 technical questions. I'll ask you simple, basic chemistry questions. Fine, I accept. He said, what is the mole of a rupee? He asked me. I said, it is a paisa. So he said, good. Then he asked me, second question, you take benzene and water, mix them, what will happen? The iPhone. What will happen? I said, they will be two layers, separate layers, benzene and water don't mix easy. Then he said, which will be the top layer? I said, obviously the benzene, which have low specific gravity, it will be on the top. He said, good. And I will ask you the third question. You take now again water and ethyl alcohol, mix them. Which will be the top layer? I said, there won't be any two layers. It will be homogeneous mixture. He said, good. And that was the end of it. And he said, you can go now. But my luck, or I can say, I was fortunate that a few days, I got the call from them that, yes, you have been selected for this fellowship. So that was my first step in getting into a sort of paramedical field, which later on, which continued. So I started working in that Institute for Research Reproduction. It was affiliated to Indian Council of Medical Research. This was one of the four institutes of the Government of India, involved in various basic medical fields in the country. One is the Institute of Virology, Pune Virus Institute, and there are a lot of other ICMR related. I joined them, and I was introduced to the fellow PhD students and the staff. Everybody was looking at me with sort of amusement, what this man is going to do. So I said, okay, let me accept the challenge. So I was asked to sit in the lab. I sat in the lab and started this library and started reading. And I was not reading, but I could not understand anything. So I was just, changing the pages. There was one lady doctor, who was anxiously looking at me. She was a lady. She came to me. Hello, young man, what are you doing? Madam, I'm trying to read, but I am not able to understand. She said, are you really interested in reading and learning? I said, of course, yes. She said, I will borrow a book. At that time, I was not allowed to borrow a book. So she borrowed a book for me. And the title was Introduction to Human Reproductive Physiology. It's an introduction. So she said, you take this book, read the first chapter, whatever you don't understand, make a note of it. And tomorrow you can come and discuss. And you underline those words which are very difficult or you are not understood. So much you'll be surprised. I virtually underlined the entire first chapter, except is, was, this and that. So and then when we saw next day, she was laughing and he said, you're really raw. I said, Sam, yes, I'm really raw. But I will definitely do or give it a try. But I assure you that I will not give it up so easily. That was my initial journey to get into IRR. And from there, I could learn slowly and gradually. A lot of determination and in getting awarded the PhD in biochemistry from Mumbai University in 1978. The topic assigned to me was the effect of vasectomy, which was used back at that time for birth control in men, and re-anastomosis, and its effect on endocrine and biochemical consequences on human reproductive organs. So basically, when I could complete it. That was after that, usually our institute was so reputed, they used to refer all the students who had done their PhD for postdoctoral fellowship. So I was also selected and offered a postdoctoral fellowship at Mount Sinai School of New York Medicine. Not in the School of Medicine, at New York, but I was very reluctant to go because the requirement of family circumstances said I must take shift day. So I just this, I mean, daily dining time. Meanwhile, one of my colleague at IRR showed me that there is an advertisement in Johnson & Johnson in the diagnostic. Would you like to apply? I applied there, and my luck would have it, I could get through. That was my first entry into Johnson & Johnson. Shall I continue in that?
Please.
So then what happened in Johnson & Johnson, when I went there, it was a small division. In a way, I always feel that it's a blessing in disguise. When you join a small division, you have a lot of opportunity to look into various other divisions. If you go to a big division and all that, you are one small part of it. Here, you are a big part of the small division. So I joined them. And I joined as a research officer. And the task before was me to be told, I was supposed to report to the medical director, one Dr. Gula, who was an eminent cardiologist. He's the medical director of Johnson. And so one day the meeting was arranged after the days of my joining. He told me that, gentlemen, you have been hired. He said, you have not been employed. That you have been hired for a specific project. That was the making these to have a good presence in pregnancy tests in latex market. And I used to import from New Brunswick, USA, and dispense it here and to set in the market. This product has to be manufactured in India, and this is your project, for which you'll be given a year's time to do it. If you don't succeed, the doors are always Johnson doors, and two from outside, so that you don't have to pull, you can go straight out. So that was the kind of, he was a very nice person. I was given brief about the product, the dermatitis, what they had from New Brunswick, the procedure, everything. Basically, the product is nothing but the polystyrene particles for which you coat human chorionic gonadotropin, HCG, is a marker for pregnancy. So that was the kind of thing. And initially, they used to use the Dow latex from there. Because of their commitment, they were not prepared to give to India, Johnson & Johnson. They had given me some other from Monsanto. So you please try these articles and take a product. So, a little nervous, what my test told. I'm looking at after 1 year, what is going to happen. So I said, okay, till at least 1 year, you are safe. So I said, let me do my best possible. I started reading on this article, HCG. The IRR was a pioneer in this HCG because IRR was the first report in the world that HCG is immunogenic. That means you can prepare the antibodies to it so that making the test for it is easy. So I'm coming from such a premier institute. That was really an advantage for me. Really, thank God I worked in IRR. So after that, I was on the job. There were about 8 particles given to me. Based on the property of each of the particles, I selected a particular particle. I still remember the code name was R2300, I still remember that particular name, mark that was. So the procedure was that when you take this mix, this, you have to carry out the reaction at elevated temperature, 50. And you have to watch the reaction from the day 7 onwards after you're graduating till day 28. That's the time that maturation of the product takes place. You know, what I did, I was so anxious. Forget about day 7, I had no patience. Day 1 only I tested it. And to my luck and to my surprise, I could get this particular, a wonderful reaction I immediately phoned to my boss. He said, "Sir, sir, we have made. Carry on, keep me posted. This development." So all this, I was very curious, and by 7 days, this product manager was selected. Had I followed their procedure of 28 days, I would have missed the. Probably I would have lost the job also, but I mean made the product. But this product was ready by day 7. So it was a very big achievement. And then what happened, this product once you make in India, you cannot put it in the market. It has to go to New Brunswick, USA, in the main headquarter. They have to evaluate this product for its stability and all that. So it all went off very well, and fortunately, by the grace of God, so they started recognizing me. And then boss told me, now take everything research-based activity in this particular division. Had about 7-8 products. They were basically known for blood grouping. Johnson is known for blood grouping worldwide because the newer blood bank was with them. India also, they were very popular on this front. So there are about 7-8 products, about 5-6 from biochemistry, and other from this, what we call, and all that. So they said, you increase the range of this product, give you all assistance. I started working on that. In chemistry, they were making reagent for glucose detection and cholesterol detection. They were very well known in that. But unfortunately, they were chemical. They have acetic. Very strong. Customer one board, they won't like kind of things. They were desperately, and there's a shortage. They cannot handle acid a large quantity. They were desperately looking for a new alternative. So I introduced a product in glucose, enzyme based, and named it as a glucosine. In cholesterol, no acid, nothing. Making is very easy. Then introduce the cholesterol, test for cholesterol, I call sign, that is the brand name. And this used to give in a powder form. You reconstitute and use for 1 month after you consume, then it becomes, you cannot use it. So I went one step ahead. Why not give in a tablet form? It can swallow this thing and reconstitute at a time and still save the reagent. So that thing is also very, very successful. So I did whatever small things possible and the immediate need of that. So company told me, now we have to look for newer tests, which have larger requirements. They were thinking of tests for hepatitis. So we had no knowledge, and I have not held it. He said, don't worry. You go to UK. In 79, to Nuffield Laboratory, UK. And also the J&J facility in Belgium. I went for about a month. They were making the product, studied their product, and tried to do it in, came back in India, and made the product in the facility. We were at Worli, and made that product, and it was successful. They launched that product also in the market, and the name referred RPHA. So company said, now you have to look for other products which are of a higher value, all that. So they asked me to go to USA in 1992 for 3 months to study the other products. So I went there, sent there in 1982, came back after 3 months and set up the procedure for different reagents they made on the new technology basis. you know, they were making the product for NTD, you know, blood group. There is NTO and called RH is called NTD. They are making NTD, and to make it workable, you have to use about 22% of the protein. It's very thick. My slide is basically a slide test. People were finding it difficult. They were looking for, we have a reagent which is. So I tried to modify, chemically modified the product. Of literature is available, not my first invention. C part of it, that is the development part of it, not R part of it. Development part, I did it successfully, sent a product to New Brunswick again. They approved it. And that's how, you know, one by one we were. Then we, Johnson Diagnostic grew big. So they found that whole place at Worli, where Flora Restaurant is there. Max must be knowing that it is on the third floor. So they asked us to move to some other bigger place. So we went to Devanar, the plant. And we were looking for a lot of other avenues to develop. Built up good number of products. There are about 14 products in eye joint. Well, in a span of about 3 to 4 years, I made them of 40 with me and my assistants and all that. So that's how, you know, we were going very strong in and on all that. So now, coming back with the reason why I had to leave the Johnson. So this is the, I must say that, I must agree that that's one of the most wonderful company to work with, because they teach you everything. They have a slogan, you work today and tomorrow you take rest. Tomorrow never comes. It's like certain things they were used to teach you about the finance when you go to ladder, because finance is so important to run or manage a business. So the things were going well and all that. And as I told you, that Johnson had a virtual monopoly in blood grouping. The blood grouping reagents, the raw material was coming from human donors. So your donors are to be immunized, and the levels are to be raised, then what is called plasmapheresis, take the blood, separate the cells, RBCs, and the plasma part of it, cells put it back, and take the plasma and process for the reagent. It was around 1984. There was a growing concern about the emergence of HIV. Everybody was scared to touch any product based on the human, source. So whole world was desperate for an alternate source for the antibiotic. So everybody was looking, where is available, who is the first, who will be going to. Meantime, in 1985, a company from France, named by Digas, they introduced their first antibody based on monoclonals. It is a tissue culture kind of things. You can produce a lot of. I wrote to them that they'll be able to give us and all that without my management knowing it, because I had a lot of risk I had taken. They are not, said yes, or either they have said they have declined it. We'll look into it. Meantime, I started pushing from my management. So here is the antibody. Here is going to be the future, because people are not going to touch the human blood-based product. They will go to monoclonal antibody-based product. So our management and is Johnson, they were very sort of complacent. Incidentally, my boss was a pharma guy. He could not understand much about diagnostics. He said, no, we are virtually monopoly in the world and all that, New York Blood Bank, blah, blah, blah. He used to say. picture, tomorrow going to be the same. Today is all right. Today we are the number one. Tomorrow we don't know where we stand. Let us at least get the raw material, put it in our product. Product will be our name. She said, no. So this gave a very, very sort of rejected and all. So in the company, I used to share is my thoughts with our product manager. One of these is the product manager. He became my partner subsequently. I used to discuss with him, see, this is what it is. What it, he also realized, he was a pharma background. He was a keen person. He has keen interest in the product. And he said, yes, it's a fundamentally excellent kind of idea. And we should, you know, do it something and all that. He also tried to back me up, but he could, what will happen? Either packets.
Sir, can you come little closer to the mic?
Yes.
We are missing your voice sometime.
Is it okay, Deepak?
Can you come little closer to the mic?
Okay.
Yeah, please. Yeah.
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 So,
yeah.
Then what happened? I have been talking to him. See, this is what it is, and I'm pressurizing him. We should, pursue this, but management was not ready to listen. Then he said, if these are the ideas and these are the things, this and all the future, why not you call a day here and look into other options? But, it's very easy to say than done, because you require a lot of resources and all that. We are thinking, we thought of, given a thought, but if you do, how will you go about it? We'll arrange the funds. Where we'll have our facility and all that. How do you? So we thought, and ultimately we said, no, there's no point. More you think, you should not think more than what is necessary. So then we decided, okay, let us call it a day. I put up my bare papers. Of course, when I wrote my resignation letter, it was kept in my pocket for at least 1 month. Because I'm not very, very confident what will happen and all that. The fat salary, we used to calculate, we make a sort of calculations. If you have a product and this is the GP, what will be the salary? Will I meet my salary, which was around 14,000 to 15,000 at that time? It's a big salary. So how are we going to do it, both of us? Equivalent salary. So I said, no, we'll quit. We quit the company. And then the first and foremost step is to register a company. So we had no money to buy or take on hire an office in Mumbai. We registered our company in one of the friends' offices in Worli, that is in Worli, and started operating for them. The office is one small room, a lot of chairs and all that. So only two of us were the directors in the company registered. And then we were desperately looking for how to start, where to start. We went to Agla State to look for a place. It was not possible. Then, in time, what happened? I read in a newspaper that one company in India, Ahmedabad, they have launched in India the first monoclonal antibodies for blood group. I told my friend, see, here is the one that's really started in India, changing the scenario. And I told him, this is what it is. And he said, yes, I know this person, this company, Nagar Ravindra from Ahmedabad. He said, I know this person who is in charge of diagnostics, and he's a good friend of mine. We were working together in HEXT, Delhi. So he was on the job to contact him, and he got all the details, and they were very keen to start their own manufacturing. They were importing the product and selling it in the market. They wanted to make that product in Ahmedabad itself. So they wanted a person who knows about all the details of manufacturing, the regulatory requirements. So I was also a little unknown that time in the industry circle. The day the moment I resigned, three companies called me whether I'm interested in joining them. One of them was Andraxi, another was Jemitra. They asked me, I said, no, I don't want to. But I went there and see how these companies function and all that. Back and ultimately, we decided we are going for our own. So my friend, he talked to the person from the Ahmedabad-based company. And he agreed that, yes, they will be definitely interested in going for the project and the manufacturing on turnkey basis. So agreement was signed. The deal was for, I still remember, it was for 7,40,000 rupees. So that includes, we'll make their facility ready. They will provide the everything. We'll build up, make the facility ready. Put up all SOPs in place. Take all regulatory requirements. Develop the, labeling and all that. Then the moment the agreement was signed, and I, the same day, that was the last day in my 3 months notice, same day, evening, I boarded train for Ahmedabad from Bombay Central to Ahmedabad and started working on that. And the terms of conditions of this particular agreement was that it's a 2 years project. And if you successfully do it, they will give us the export right of the product to African countries. So they said, Dave, do you do well? We will do this. Okay. We were very happy. I went there, worked day and night and all that. And I'm glad to say that we could finish that entire project just in 6 months. So we had a lot of time and all that. Then myself and my friend said, why now you have to be at the mercy of these people? Because we have to wait for another year and then do all these things and all that. Instead of, why not we say thank you to them and say goodbye. So this was communicated to his friend who was in charge and his friend. And he was a little upset. Oh no, we wanted to do so many things to you, but I know that. But my partner, he gave him a counter offer. You are also an employee there. Why don't you join us? And thus, he became the third partner in the company. And the next day after that meeting, we came to Bombay, sat and decided what to do. Everything was planned. And then we said, we'll make a first product, that is the bovine serum, albumin from bovine serum. It is the basic material used for all the reagents. So we said, where will we make? We tried nearby places, but could not. Then we went to Dairi in Simhagarh Road, Pune. There we took an hire a industrial shed, which was sort of unauthorized industrial. We put up our machine there, the Sharple centrifuge, which runs at around 22,000 revolutions per minute. We put up that machine there, and it was again rental. And I started operating from there. Every day I used to travel from Mulund to Pune. And that time, I don't know now that train, that's that train called Indrayani Express. It used to leave at 6:20 in the morning and reach Pune by 9 o'clock. And the same train, it leaves back for Mumbai, I think the afternoon at 4 o'clock. I used to come by that train, reach home around 10 o'clock. This I continue to do for about 3 months. But the biggest problem was there was a lot of power problem in that particular industrial estate. So you could not sustain. We hired one employee there as a helper. Today, this helper is our chief of Bombay office. In the just matter of so many years. He just joined as a helper to me, and he is the chief of our Bombay office. So from there, we decided there's no point in continuing this. We'll be wasting our time. So all the three of us came to Mumbai. From Mumbai to Goa, looking for a suitable place. Question is, why Goa? That was the partner. He used to love to Goa when he used to travel as a product manager from J&J. And because Goa is a place where everybody likes. He said, okay, we'll make this as a place. I readily accepted because it's closer to me. It is next to my house. So that was the fascination for Goa. So we came to Goa, look for various places and all. And we were very clear on how to go about it. We'll not be able to build our own premises. We have to look for rental premises. We could locate a small premises at Old Goa. The owner has made it for his garment house, garment products. We took it on rent out to, because our products have to be approved by the Food and Drug Administration. So we took then the controller to Costa Frias as a wonderful gentleman, came with us. We showed him. And in the Drug Act, there is a schedule called Schedule M. It talks about what kind of manufacturing facility we have. So we are not at all complying with the Schedule M of the Drug Act. But he said, don't worry, it is within my purview that I can grant you a license provided you do a good job. He told him, sir, we'll do the best to our ability. Definitely we'll do the best. And that area is about 1,400 square feet. We modified that area. He had two toilets. In a drug facility, you require what is called airlocks. In these two toilets, we converted into airlocks. So of course, with the concurrence of the drug controller, we got the license. Then we started the manufacture. One is Sandesai, who was there, the assistant drug controller. He also helped a lot. I must also thank to S.D. Sawant. He spoke to him, say, he's my man, you try to help him. So that's how the things went smoother for us, and we started manufacturing the product. And then our idea was that initially to keep the bare minimum possible, the areas and all that, we'll not spend more and all that. The thing is, as far as the finance is concerned, coming back to that, it was very limited. So we made a sort of self-regulations. We had all company cars, all three of us. We had given it up, those all cars. We'll not travel by air. We'll travel by bus. Number of times I have traveled from Goa to Mumbai by bus, my friends. So that's how we said we'll keep the cost minimum. And let me tell you, when we made the first batch of the pregnancy test, latex base, we got an order from Dr. Reddy's Laboratory, Hyderabad. So myself and my other partner, we sat in a bus, a transport bus, over to Hyderabad to deliver the goods. That's how we said we'll have a sort of strict financial control measures so that the money can be judiciously used. Then we said how to increase the product range. We said, Lord, we don't have that much capability of research and all that. Start sort of putting somebody's product. So we talked to a company, Swiss company, Amid, and an excellent blood group use, and the coagulation product. So that was a lot of, we brought a raw material, we formulated it here and started entry into the market with monoclonal antibodies. So that was a ready acceptance in the market. So we, what we did, we will said we are that we will not make me too products. What products we are making in Johnson & Johnson, we will make different products which will be beneficial to the customer. I give you an here example. Johnson had a product for the rheumatoid arthritis detection. So that product is such that when you take for testing, the when you collect the blood serum, you have to dilate 1 in 40 times and then subject to test. So there's a one particular step. In between year two, you said, this step can be avoided, this step, so that it is handy for customer. But dilution can lead to an error. And one more step, you reduce. So we introduced a product without dilution, and it was a big success. So we introduced other products like C-reactive protein and streptolysin O for infection in children. So that one by one, we kept on putting the product in the market, which has a ready acceptance or beneficial to the customers as a on the table to use it. So that's how we, then when we started getting the money, then we said, let us go for a own premises. Then we had a first office in Bamboli. In that part of the office, we used to have a small laboratory also. Then, by the grace of God, when it grew, then we shifted to Verna, next to Kamla Chow. He was really, I used to look at him when we wanted to start. Here is somebody who has made the community proud. He and both Shivanam, they were my sort of role model initial stage. Here are these two people who has guided me or think me that I can also succeed. 1 minute. So then when we moved to Verna, we started making all the products, newer products, pregnancy tests, or the latex space where the woman has to collect urine and take it to the lab. Lab will add the two reagents and carry out the test and be a sort of cumbersome. And it only was a less sensitive because it can be detected pregnancy after the 14 days of expected menstruation. Women have to detect on expected day of menstruation. It is better for the pregnancy regulatory control and all that. So there was a desperate need for the sensitive test. We developed new sensitive tests, direct sensitive tests. Then subsequently, their demand required because it's women are little hesitant to go to a doctor, and so we introduced the rapid test by the name called CLU. It's an immunochromatography test wherein you have a device, you use 2 drops of urine, and after 5 minutes, you see whether there are 2 lines. If it is line and test line is positive. So then what happened? Even that there was a sort of operation, you have to collect and add. Then we said, can it be further improved? So we came out with a midstream urine test. What does it mean? Is woman has to take the device, open it, go to the toilet, directly urinate on that, and after 5 minutes, you see the results. So it's totally sort of, completely kept sort of secret and all that. So all these things were need of the, the people, the women. So we try to do it very successful. Now there are people also, there are tests being done in the market. They want to go for saliva-based tests. You don't have to collect urine, just put a drop of saliva and see whether the woman is pregnant or not. So these kind of things. Another thing is about the coagulation test. Johnson was a leader in the coagulation, but they had a freeze-dried product. And that, once you reconstitute, pre-diagnosis process itself is tedious. You cannot have a, capacity constraint. We said, why not we may make a product which is liquid stable, and you could make it in no time. And today, you'll see this is one of the largest selling product in the range of tulip products, and exported to a number of countries in large quantity, bulk liter. And so, blood grouping also monoclonal we introduced. And then the testing was you take on the side, add this thing, mix it, and see. That was that cumbersome. Then we said, why not develop a sort of test where somebody can read directly, the patient can read. We developed a card test. Dispense the reagent, just put the blood, you know, spin it, and you get the results. Now, the card system, the trade name, has been upgraded certain level that when you just give the blood, the result go to the, you know, where patient is housed. So that is the kind of exploration is taking place in the field of diagnostic. And we were, every stage we try to do the best possible. You know? That's how we could succeed because of the constant vigil on the technology, and always the customer is always in front of you, what he or she needs. So that was the kind of approach we had. And that's how we could when we started with the air products, there are over now 1,000 products. We have a, you know, catalog. It's as good. Somebody must have seen the Sigma catalog. It's as big as a Sigma catalog with all the technical details. That's how the story of from my PhD to coming back to a formidable level in diagnosis in this country.
Thank you, sir.
Anything?
Thank you very much. So let's move on to the second question. The second question that today topic of everyone interest, the adapting the pace of technological change. Sure. As we all know, the keeping up with the pace of technological change is tough. And all business leader, not just the baby boomers also, may find this solution or a strategic approach that helps them to get the best outcome from the technology investment. In that sense, Dr. Vinayak Babu, give us a sense, how do you see the adapting the high pace of technological change, and why this is vital in today's industries, both in startup and entrepreneurial business venture, to gain advantage and create value? So also we wanted to hear from you, what are all the challenges you faced during your time, and how do you overcome to make life easier for your customer also and employee with the help of technological change management? Over to you, Dr. Vinayak.
Yeah, thank you, Subhash. Going back to your first question, the technology, you know, this age of technology in every field. When Kamlaksh will tell you in his areas and all that, doctor. As far as diagnostics concerned, everything is rapidly changing. Technology is only not on the you know, product per se. It is also the procedure of, you know, performing the test. In like many tests, you just like see today's scenario in COVID tests. People are going for technology. One is there is a rapid antigen test, where this is a just an antigen antibody based test, but it has got a limitation, both specificity and sensitivity. People always prefer RT-PCR test, this reverse, because this COVID is a RNA based virus, and you have to catch the right RNA and convert it into DNA, you know, and then measure. There are a lot of, you see, there is a very, I mean, it's not the topic we can discuss, it's a very elaborate. You have to have a thermocycler from that, and then you measure. There is a dye, this is measured, and sir, that foreign dye is really the quicker in the region. That's why they call it the cycle. Your minimum that you turn, run nowadays in present listing is 35 cycles. But there is also a sort of the request from the industry, instead of going to 35 cycles, can you go to 25 cycles? So that the time required will be less. And even because it's a stronger positivity will come in the earlier phase also. So this technology, what is, is so important. It only is a convenience point of view, also the reliability point of view. Hello?
Yes, yes, go on, sir.
Yeah. This regarding the you said what are the initial difficulties faced and all that. Like any entrepreneur has a similar three main difficulties usually they face. One is the finance, second is the infrastructure, and third is the manpower. So for us, fortunately, our financial requirements were taken care of by the project work which we did. But still, we had put certain restrictions on ourselves that I told you will not travel by air. You know, I have not mentioned, we were almost getting the salary in the tune of around 14,000 to 15,000 J&J. How much salary we drew first time when you became the director of Tulip Diagnostic? 4,000 rupees. So 14 to 15,000, we came to 4,000 rupees. Said, no, we'll continue to do this as far as you have to grow and get the muscle power that we can, fully change things. So traveling also, as I told you, we'll not travel by air and all that, we'll travel by bus. So we could manage that. And most of the work, in the manufacturing. That's also, we'll take care of the infrastructure. We said, no, we are going to have our own factory. We're going to have a rental premises made that way, that infrastructure was created. And I used to manufacture product myself. My other two partners, they used to help me in labeling, filling, labeling, and packing. And one also used to prepare the invoice on a typewriter machine, still which is I have kept in the factory and just for remembrance. So these things were used to less number of people. And I said that even we had the first consignment, myself and my friend went to deliver to Hyderabad to Dr. Randy's labor. So this is how, slowly we tried to take care of this. And once we started getting the enough resources, we kept on venturing into different units. And fortunately, we must say, we are also fortunate that when we moved to Goa, to our advantage, there was tax holidays were announced, and we have taken the best use of all the tax holidays. The moment you have a new technology, make a new division and put it into that in a partnership company where you know that at one point, otherwise the private limited at 2 point personal as well the corporate. So we took the advantage of all the things whichever is available. So that's how we could slowly build upon and take care of these changes. Regarding the adaptation of that, I've already given. You want me to hear more information on that?
No, that's perfectly fine. But in the public question also, we will be covering some of the part also. So yes, I will move on to the third question now.
I will definitely cover.
Yeah. So this is the final question from KME end, and forum is open for all the live questions here onwards. So request you to please type and share your questions if any. So Dr. Vinayak, a lot of entrepreneurs must have approached you for seeking advice. What are the most frequent kind of mistakes a new entrepreneur does and fails? What will be your message or advice or cautions to any new entrepreneurs from our community so that one can ability to conceptualize the idea at the same time scaling up the business and at the same time face the fierce competition from the competitors? Over to Dr. Virag.
Yeah, see, I mean, I can tell you based on my this thing. See, when anybody want to become an entrepreneur, what is very scarce and very rare is your finance. How do you control? Most of the people, they make mistake. I've seen some of my friends also, they have made a mistake. They want to make a nice office. They want to prepare some the foreign visitors and all that. Factories, nice cars and all that. So all these employ people where one can manage, they will employ a number of people more and all that. These kind of deeds or things which really don't help you to take care of your business initially. Whenever it is that will be need-based. You require it, you do it. You don't require, you better do yourself. I'll tell you one instance in Chile. There was an urgent order to be delivered at the airport. So we started at 9 o'clock in the morning. We finished at 5 a.m. next day morning. I was there whole day. My partners were there. Finished everything. And then we drove to the airport to deliver the goods. Here what happens, you have to see how you can minimize the expenses because resources are very, very scarce. And your technology. You have to think, I want to do a product. Who is going to buy it? Your customer. What are his needs? You may make something big, but customer doesn't want that big thing. Because your big thing will cost you big money to him. So you will have to think, what is that it is required? Those kind of things, you have to be a very, very, precise on that. Spending, Bandal Baba.
Is this audible?
Yeah, it's audible. Okay, please go on.
Yeah, the spending and all that is absolutely, you have to be, every equipment, everything you buy, has to be well justified and well thought. I'll give you an example. This is a very, very, very nice example, which I liked it. When we were thinking of appointing distributor, I went to Bangalore to appoint a distributor in Bangalore. Our precondition, first condition that you have to have a small office, doesn't matter, but you have to have a walk-in cooler so that our products are thermal stable at 228 degrees centigrade. And his name was Mr. Desai. I'm telling you, this is very interesting. So I asked him, will you be able to do it? He said, okay. And we're supposed to meet in the evening for that dinner. I told him to come for that. So we went to the dinner table. He came to me and told me one thing very humbly. Sir, I have a request. What is that request? Instead of one walking cooler, can I buy 10 refrigerators? Is he a mad person? I'm asking to buy one walking cooler. And he said he will buy 10 refrigerators. I was also amused. He's a Gujarati by this thing. I asked him, what is the reason instead of one walking cooler you want to go to 10 refrigerators? What he told me? Sab banda nahi chalta hai. So walking cooler bechna difficult hai. Main refrigerator bech sakta. You understand? See how particular each investment at him, yes. He said, uska minimize losses concept. Okay. So these things one has to operate. And your technology. When coming to that, this is one of the investment part. Technology, how solid is the technology? Or is the need to technology? What is the benefit you are going to give to your customer? So you have to. Acceptability has to be there in the market. Who will except in the market, if you go to a meat product with a price, there is no benefit and all that, it will not. Somebody may buy because if he knows. But on a regular repeat orders and all that will not come unless there is a substantially improvement in terms of price benefits or technological benefits. So these things people have to take in mind. And you'll also think, I'm just making this product today. What is going to happen tomorrow? What is going to happen day after tomorrow? You know, there's a very one interesting thing was in Johnson. As every research manager at the end of the year, he has to give what product will be required 10 years hence. So you have to give a write-up to them. 10 years, 5 years hence, 10 years hence. See the way that those people do. So same concept to be, you know, taken by any budding entrepreneur. Yes, I'm starting today. Because your investment will be there. You don't want to, you know, wind it up maybe by next year and all that, maybe a year later. So you have to be realistic about the future business. Yeah. See, you put yourself into your customer's shoe and see, will I buy a product? If somebody comes to me, how am I going to react to it? So these things, you know, Subhash, these are very important in your strategy. Doesn't matter. Start small. Somebody was asking, how do you, I mean, are you going to come to that? How are you going to start and all that? No.
No, that's perfectly fine. Yeah. So, there's enough questions are there from the live community also. So, I'll just read it for you. The forum is open for all the live questions from the YouTube live community. The first question is coming from Dr. Anil Gaonkar, Amdaldi Karwar.
Yes.
So, he is just asking, in your opinion, what are the top 2 to 3 entrepreneurial skills one should possess us in order to set up Atmanirbhar small scale businesses?
Right. I mean, Subhash, it's a combination of skills one require. First, according to me, you should have a thorough concurrent product knowledge, along with a good understanding of the finance and the market requirements. Second is, the person should be a very effective implementer, or you can call it an effective leader, so that he can, you know, guide and help his employees. And third, you know, whenever anything, I think it should be the most important, he should have a passion for his work. He should have a drive, he should have a determination and all that, and also should be able to stay positive in difficult times. So these are the certain things that are very, very, very important for a person to look into venturing. I'll tell you one of the nice sort of sequential, this thing is given by one very famous doctor and is a philosopher. He says, for anybody to start anything or do anything, first you have to have a belief that I can do it. So your belief gets converted into your thoughts. Okay? Thoughts gets converted into your actions. Okay? Actions become your habits. Habits become your character. And if you always have, your destiny is made. So that's how he is very nicely has summed it up. If you have all these things, belief to thought, thought to action, action to habits, habits to character, character to destiny. So that's all sums up what kind of person or one should prepare himself so that he can be a successful entrepreneur.
Nice. So second question is coming from Rupali Salunke from Asnoti Karwar. Yeah. So you have been one of the highest recruiters of our community people. What would your piece of advice to youngsters when they seek jobs from our community industrialists?
Yeah, if somebody wants to seek job from either our community person, entrepreneur, or anybody, the philosophy remains the same. First of all, you should think that I require the job and not the company, you know. And you should feel that I'm not joining the company mere sake of the salary. Salary can get anywhere. You can do thefts also, you can make money. And it's not only your taking for the year. Second, you have to think that my career depends on, will depend on this, my progress in this organization. I will also grow as the company grows. Me and my family is dependent on this organization. Always talk positive about the company. There are many people say, hey, what company is mine, this, also positive, and feel positive or talk positive about your company and your products. Many people don't know the company, what product they make. They are totally blind. Try to understand what product they make and for what, and be, you know, happy and be, I mean, feel proud. That's what I can say, that when you have to think of or trying to join any organization.
Correct. Thank you. So the third question is coming from Sri Narayan Savan, Bart Savankwada. I am sure a lot of young entrepreneurs would like to benefit from your wisdom and experience. And this was a query first initially. And he is asking, would you be open to mentor or help or nurture these our young qualified people so that they can think of starting their own small scale business in the area where they are confident in?
Yeah, definitely. It will be better for me. And just let them approach me for any help they need. It will be really a pleasure for me.
Perfect. Yeah, the third question is coming from Kishore Naik, Thane, Mumbai. So everyone say an entrepreneur never retires. So yes. What are your current activities? Any thoughts on how do you intend to give back to society?
Yes. Yeah. Kishore's question has, I can put it into, frame it into three sub-questions. One is, you know, this everyone says entrepreneur never retires. Yes, he's right. Entrepreneur never retires. He's busy one or the other way. So second is, what is your current activities? Currently, I do a lot of time to read, which I could not in the past totally. I do that. Also, in touch with the company on technical matters as and when they approach me for this. And thirdly, most important is I spend a lot of time with grandchildren, and also we are developing an agricultural activity in Karwar. That's how I spend my present time. And is the last is, any thoughts, how do you intend to give back to society? So, I want to tell Kishore that the question has to be sort of rephrased, not intend. I'm already doing it. This I have been doing since last so many years, either it is a religious or educational or social. And just to give him a recent example, we have donated this week, 10,000 units of Fabiflu and methyl prednisolone to a Mumbai-based hospital which takes care of COVID-19 patients. And if Kishore has any specific things in mind, he is most welcome to discuss with me. It will be a pleasure for
him. Thank you, sir. So, the fifth question is coming from Puneet Rane, Vashi, Mumbai. Yeah. It's technology-oriented kind of a question. The point-of-care diagnostics are predominantly...
It is Puneet or Santosh.
Yeah. What are the top challenges in B2C business line and how to overcome them?
Yeah. See, what Rane has said is right. In India, it is most of the diagnostic or point-of-care business is... B2B, business to business. That is because the level of understanding in Indian people is not that high compared to any other countries. Can I just give an example? The money spent in US on drug or medicinal products is suppose $100. They also spent another $100 on diagnostics. Whereas in India, if you spend 100 rupees for medicine, you spend only 2 rupees for diagnosis. You see the difference. It's only because of not needed, but because of your understanding. So you are not able to understand what is the importance of diagnostics, reagents, or the point of care, one of the part of the diagnostic. The overcome is to educate. Tell them how what you can do. You don't have to go rush to the doctor. You don't have to, you know, be in a panic and all that. These tests can be done. So he has given an example, point of care, next question. Point of care diagnostics, new avenues other than pregnancy tests, blood sugar and pulse oximetry. You know, these are the country, most of the people now use awareness. You should go to a medical shop or over the counter, you buy all these things. There are a lot of other point of care tests like glycated hemoglobin, which is the new marker people prefer for diabetes. There's also occult blood, that is very mean, the colonal cancer and all that. That's also a point of care test. Malaria, falciparum or Vivax or dengue kind of. There are also tests available now, point of care for blood group. And then, of course, the rapid antigen tests and all that. So many things. There are many, many, you know, tests. But some of these tests require, you know, usually a point of care at a customer level is what? At P&C level, you know, the user level. It should be preferably a single step. But the multiple step, they will not be able to do it. They will not be able to interpret the results also. I'll give you one very lively example I faced in Karwar. One of product was being used at pregnancy test, you know, rapid pregnancy test, flow-through test. The one lab complained to me that there are no results coming. All are washed off in your, you know, pregnancy tests. All, you know, we tried so many samples, there are no results at all. Surprise. I said, let me go and see what is happening. So the person, the technician, was a new technician. Along with that reagent device, he provided dropper for urine addition. So, and if you read properly, that you said, add 2 drops of urine. What this girl used to do, take full of this dropper full and do push like this entire amount of, you know, urine she used to, and that used to wash off. So what I mean to say is the, you know, knowledge, training and understanding. She said, adding urine, you had to, I have added more. No, that is not. Because the procedure has certain steps you have to follow. So awareness in handling or reinterpretation of the test result is very, very important.
Great. So there's one more question is coming from YouTube community. He's a youngster, Raghvendra Naik from Karwar.
Yeah.
He wants your advice. He said, I am 29 years old and I am still not able to decide whether to focus on job or start a new business. I have a business idea that can implement it in the Karwar. But yeah. I'm worried about my job as well. Need suggestion whether to focus on job or go with the business.
You know, yes, he appears to be a little, you know, in a dilemma. I don't say confused. If his idea, he is sure about it, and this is going to give his business idea, he's going to take care of his long-term business. Maybe for a few years. He can do without much, you know, financial burden. My advice is to go for it and not look for it. So he can discuss with me if really. I'll be glad to talk to him.
Sure. Yeah, there's one more question from Shripad Mahableshwar Naik, Mumbai.
Yeah. Yes.
Whenever anyone thinks of starting a business, first think of money and investment part requirement.
Yeah.
And second is the setting the differentiated products in the market. How these two things should be tackled? So that's what is.
See, the first thing the finance he's talking about. If my suggestion, if one has adequate financial resources, go for your own manufacturing. The second alternative is if it is not possible, your own premises, you go for rental premises for the manufacturer. Even that is not possible, you get it manufactured through a third party. Under your own, that you can take care of the manufacturing part. Regarding the sales, the possibility is you can have your own sales distribution. The advice is when you have your same distribution, don't go to multiple centers, go to a few centers and market the product. It is beneficial. You can see what are the difficulties you face, customer acceptance and all that. Do it. And second is, if it is not possible, see, you make it the product for somebody else and somebody else sells your product through him. So that way you can take care of the sale also.
Okay. So there's one more question is coming from Rupa Naik. So she's asking your suggestion. How can we stop migration of well-qualified young generation from Karwar?
You provide them, you know, the facilities so that they can stay there, that the industry should come in Karwar, or they should start their own. Because, see, Karwar, any business has to survive. There should be adequate, you know, buyers. So this is very important, you know. Otherwise, your, you know, distributor expenses, your logistic expenses, and all that communications becomes a big problem. So only thing, the big industries come, then only it is possible that migration can be.
So Kambach Pau, we want your presence now. If you can ask some of your questions also directly to Vinayak Pau. Take a blush mode. She come blush mode. If you can hear us. Okay, I'll just ask you one more question directly coming from the YouTube. So this is from Amit Naik, Mumbai. Do you think technology changes have made humans too much dependent and less inquisitive about the things?
I don't think so. Yes, the technology has made things easier and better for human. You know that it does not mean that thinking process of human will diminish. It will still go on. And he doesn't have to think that our thinking, this incapacity will diminish.
Perfect. So, suppose if Kamlaksh Bahu is not available, so then I'll just... looks like we covered most of our questions so far. Yeah. Deepak Bhau, suppose if you have some questions from the YouTube's community, you can directly post it.
Sure. Question. Your insights into labor management in India. Subhash?
Yeah, Dr. Vinayak Pau. So he's asking your insights on the labor management, how you're managing the labor in your factories and all. So that's what he's asking on the insights.
labor management is, see, previously we used to take the direct recruitees on our payroll, but now we are getting through contract, so it becomes easier for us to manage people when the size of the employees are large. And we have now, as far as the initial recruitment of the higher ups, workers we don't take now on our payroll, we have to contract supply. But other staff, chemist, the office staff, they are selected by us based on their merits and.
So, looks like we covered most of our questions so far. So, once again, I would like to give special thanks to Dr. Vinayak Naik taking time out from your schedule. And thank you, Dr. Vinayak Bo. It's wonderful insights to share with us. Today, he talked about the life-changing entrepreneurial journey, talked about the webinar topics also, and gave his valuable insights to our young entrepreneurial aspirants. Dr. Vinayak Bo, you wanted to share some of your any closing note?
Yeah.
Now, can you hear me?
Yeah, Kamalaksh, I can hear you.
My God. Sorry, I don't know, something wrong with this phone, but I hardly use this phone, you know. I use on my iPad. This time I use phone, I'm at home. Sorry. I wanted to ask you only one thing. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
See, normally, you see, it looks like you are not, I mean, to be very frank, it's not a personal question. I just wanted to know why you are not still involved in your company, because you started everything the way everything you explained, you know, in my case also similar thing, but I'm still hanging on, you know. So why you left early, or you are not getting involved in Tulip? I understand. So what is that?
No. The thing is, Kamalaksh, when we started the company, I mean, I'll give you a, take you back. You know, it was a sort of, now it is a private limited company. It was a partnership company. So, okay. Three partners. Okay. And we had made, certain sort of unwritten rules that in the organization, they will not employ any, you know, relatives, either belong to us two or our wives, will not take it in the any administrative position. Third, when I become 65 year old, when I cross that, company will look for a multinational company who can take this company further. And thing is, we will not give the company to any partner under any circumstances.
Okay. I see.
So that was the reason. Say, one partner, suppose if he takes over, he said, no, I got at a very, you know, little higher price and all that, or we have given it a lower this thing and all. So that this was the sort of planned when we were into the business, and we made it very clear among us that we will only adhere to these norms in the time to come.
Okay. Because I thought you being involved and being the
person, definitely, yeah.
You know, the normally what happens, the person who is involved right from beginning, he becomes a first entrepreneur. By again, you are taking partners and all that, they are there, but he remains with the company, whereas the other guys can leave or whatever it is. No, so no. You being everything, why you left? I was a little confused.
No, and now, you know, for your information, Kamalaksh, all three have left the company.
I see. Okay, yeah. Okay.
None of them are there in the company. Only the Perkin Elmer, you know, that we just take on our ass, you know.
Okay.
Yeah, they had put a precondition.
I see.
One of the person will work for a few years till their management takes over. That's why the youngest of us is in the business as an employee.
Okay. That's their normal. Yes. That's the normal. Yes. Okay. Good. You're lucky. Good. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Any other questions from anyone? Final questions? Yeah, we wanted to add closing note with the. So, Dr. Vinayak, you wanted to share something?
I want to thank the young stalwarts, Subhash and Siddesh, for giving me opportunity to share my whatever ideas which I can. And also the other members who joined, Deepak and Kamlaksh and all these people who have eminent personalities who have joined. I also thank them for the wonderful conversation, and I wish you all the best, and request you to take care of yourself from present pandemic, and wish you all the best and your family. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir. We will come back to you for the other suggestions also, how to make this program in a very effective way.
Dr. Subhash?
Yeah.
I would like to just say thank you to Sir Dr. Vinayak Naik. Sir, after I was in my second semester of management studies, and I came to your house. Mama introduced me to you. I still remember that visit and got inspired by your work and by your passion.
Yeah, Deepak. I mean, I've been telling about you to so many people that if you want to do anything in pharma-related thing, please speak to me. I'll speak to Deepak.
Thank you so much for the inspiration that you, Kamlaksh Kaka, and SD Sawan sir has given to our community.
Correct.
You are an inspiration for us.
That was when we were thinking. I personally was thinking. I was only looking at these two guys, Kamlaksh and Shivanand. Because they were, these people have done, why we can also try. What is the harm in trying that? And fortunately, they have an opportunity to interact with Kamlaksh today. It's really wonderful.
We have to encourage the young people. That's the only thing we have to think.
Yeah, that's true, Kamlaksh. I really agree with you. And sure, even if one or two also makes the thing, and we should be very glad to see that.
See, I have seen because I'm having R&D and everything in Bangalore, I come across so many startup companies, but not our KME people, but others, whatever it is. But I have not come across anybody, entrepreneur, want to become entrepreneur, because they come with some product XYZ. But I have not come with anyone, that they are ready to work, like what you have done. Is great. Okay.
Yeah.
For that, because you have taken initiative, you have done everything. Like I have also done same thing. But there are people, if you see, I'll give you a simple example. If they come out with some know-how, and when you show them interest, they open their mouth so much, then you can't talk to them at all. And ultimately, they go back to their job, leaving that. Many companies in Bangalore, at least 4 or 5 companies I have seen, they come up with their startup companies, but nobody takes, they think, they have done some miracle and they want, let's say I take interest in that. Then pehla bolega, iska paisa kitna hai, ye hai. That's a very thinking, very less people are real. These are not fit to become entrepreneur. They are not at all. That's what I feel bad, So anybody is coming, they should come prepared. Then it is okay. Correct?
Yeah, absolutely correct. Absolutely. They should, sort of a detailed roadmap they have to prepare. And wherever they have to reach at a particular point of this, they should come and discuss. And those people who can guide them or help them. That has to be the approach.
There are many people like Puni's father. He has also come up hard way. RRR Industries.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Okay.
Because he keeping quiet. Puneet just keeping quiet.
Thank you, Kamlaksh Bho, and yes. Thanks, Deepak Dada, for the kind words. So, on closing note, I would also like to thank for all the wonderful community people and all our KME backend and frontline friends like Deepak Bhau, Siddesh, Puneet, Kishore, Suraj, Kiran, Pankaj, and host of all others, and amazing support lineup. So, aaj zalele karyakramache telecast ami YouTube channel achar kartele. Please like kara, share kara, and comment kara. So till then, please stay tuned to the next episode with the Konkan Maratha Samaj, empowering Atmanirbhar community platform. Kitak sub zara maaf kara. Thank you all.
Konkan Maratha Entrepreneurs presents Champions of Innovation Series.